The essay, that is Derrida's Structure, Sign and Play, from where we have stopped yesterday. So we were discussing the nature culture binary that is taken up by Levi-Strauss and how he proceeded to establish this definition of nature and culture as we have seen in yesterday's lecture. So today, let us continue from where we have already stopped, and let me share the screen first. Yeah, I hope the screen is visible to you. This is the text, and the text is with you in the PDF format. So you can please open the text and follow where I am reading out and then explaining. So, after stating how Levi-Strauss began his work, his research work, with the binary of nature and culture, which of course could not, you know, the binary as he assumed to be, you know, as we have seen in the previous paragraphs, Levi-Strauss could not continue that we have seen. So, Derrida says that this example of this binary shows how the language of human sciences operates or proceeds to explore the history of structure or metaphysics based on the presence of a binary structure. And then he continues, this example, which is given in a very cursory manner, in a brief manner, according to Derrida, is only one among many others. But nevertheless, it already shows that language bears within itself the necessity of its own critique. This is very important. This is the idea of post-structuralism also. So taking the example of the binary system, which is there in the culture or in the language itself, Levi-Strauss could not stick on to his own definitions of nature or culture when he came to one particular scandal, which is called a scandal, but it no more remains a scandal after it is not fit into any, it fit into the binary of nature culture. So that is incest prohibition that we have seen already. So taking this example, Derrida says that language possesses in itself its own critic. And how, based on this characteristic of language, no, this is the innate characteristic of language that Derrida is referring to, particularly the language of human sciences. That is why the essay is named as Structure, Sign and Play in the Discourse of Human Sciences. So Derrida says, now based on the nature, the innate nature of the language, Levi-Strauss of course tried to present the scandal, but of course that was no more a scandal, and which cannot be fixed either into nature or culture. So based on this, Derrida says, this critic may be undertaken along two paths, okay, in two manners. So what are these two paths, and what are the two manners? Let us see. according to Derrida, actually. One is the first path where he is giving in this paragraph. Once the limit of the nature-culture opposition makes itself felt. So when the researcher understands the limitations for this binary of nature-culture, when he realizes it immediately, what the researcher will want to do. So one might want to question systematically and rigorously the history of these concepts. So Derrida says that as and when the researcher realizes that nature culture opposition has a limit, okay, immediately the researcher will try to go into a rigorous exploration or excavation like thing in a systematic manner to the history of these concepts, a historical trace out of the definitions of nature, culture, when it was started, etc. But Derrida in the following lines says, this of course cannot be considered as either a philological or philosophical action in the classic sense of these words. Philological is pertaining to language, and philosophical of course is pertaining to the philosophy. Okay. The nature of human life or the nature of word, etc., all those things. So Derrida says that this method, that means the first method, of course, is not possible. And though people asserted of doing something in this way, according to Derrida, it was not successful. So he says that all those attempts to trace out the history of these concepts will be swallowed up in metaphysics, in the entire body of discourse which they claim to have disengaged from it. Whatever attempts that will be made in this systematical study of the history of the concepts will end up only in the repetition of the Western metaphysics. So this method, according to Derrida, is not successful. Then he comes to the second method, and he says, Derrida says, the second method is the one which, of course, Levi-Strauss also has taken. So the other choice, in order to avoid the possibly sterilizing effects of the first one, so to avoid the danger of getting swallowed up in metaphysics, if we explore from the first method, the second method consists in conserving all these old concepts within the domain of empirical discovery, while here and there denouncing their limits, treating them as tools which can still be used. So Derrida says that the second method is, instead of going into the history, either of philology or philosophy of these concepts, the researcher will continue to use them as tools whenever possible, and he will not care for their limits. He will use them, he may change them, or he may actually alter, and he makes them a method, or he can make them as instruments, etc. And he says that when truth value is not attributed to them, there is a readiness to abandon them for other instruments. So this second method will never bothers to attribute any limitations to this. And so Lévi-Strauss says that if truth value is removed from them, there is a danger that the researcher will forsake them or leave them. Okay, so he says that their efficacy, okay, the ability to produce the desired result, the word's efficacy, will be exploited to destroy the old machinery. So old machinery is whatever is there in the old system of knowledge, etc. So Lévi-Strauss thinks that by retaining their truth value and applying them as and when necessary and arriving at some conclusions is a good alternative. And then he says, Derrida says that this is very important because Lévi-Strauss, instead of abandoning the binary, even if he realized that this is not really a binary, he proceeded on with that. So he realized, actually, he in his book Elementary Structures has begun with this binary, and later, after say 13 years, of course, he himself stated, he means here Lévi-Strauss, stated the opposition between nature and culture, to which I attached much importance at one time, now seems to be of primarily methodological importance. So he, of course, no more treating them as exact binaries and not even he is abandoning them or he's leaving them. He's continuing with them, but he changed the nature in which those words are being used in his research. That is why he says this first enterprise opens the way for others. So he proceeded with firstly with this binary. Whether it is true or false, or whether it is there or not, is another matter. But proceeding on that belief of the binary, he arrived, or his research opened up some other ways to read some other sciences. And thus, Derrida says that language of the social sciences criticizes itself in this way. The language of social sciences is taken and it is used to present the critique of its own. That is what he says. And further, Derrida takes up one more concept. So, actually, based upon the progress of research in Lévi-Strauss, who is a researcher in human sciences, and how he used the concepts in building up the knowledge or his research, Derrida examines that Lévi-Strauss, without stating, has touched one important nature of the language, that is, language providing its own critique. And Lévi-Strauss, as he progresses in his study, he could not fix to his first statement, but he made a contradictory of his own statement, that there is a necessity to integrate culture in nature. So that is how he proceeded. Then Derrida takes up another concept of Lévi-Strauss, which is bricolage. Bricolage is, what is a bricolage? This is more important. You may get this bricolage in short answers. He says that in his work, The Savage Mind, Lévi-Strauss presents as what he calls bricolage, what might be called the discourse of this method. So, how he used the concepts that are already existing for his purposes, for his purposes of research, which is focused in a different manner. Okay, so he used this word bricolage, and then from bricolage, he says, he brings out a person who is a bricolier. Okay, who is this bricolier? According to Lévi-Strauss, bricolage is a necessary tool for research in the human sciences, and the man who uses it becomes the bricolier. Okay, so bricolier, says Lévi-Strauss, is someone who uses the means at hand, the instruments he finds at his disposition around him, those which are already there, which had not been, just a minute, I think I have missed the page. Yeah, which had not been especially conceived with an eye to the operation for which they are to be used, and to which one tries by trial and error to adopt them, not hesitating to change them whenever it appears necessary, or to try several of them at once, even if their form and their origin are heterogeneous, and so forth. So who is a bricolier? A bricolier is one researcher who uses the resources at his hand. They might be belonging to any of the fields, and they may not be especially made or conceived for his operation, for his single operation, etc. Or he never tries to adopt them by trial and error, like as it happens in sciences. You know, we say always the scientific adaptation. Okay, nowadays you have this discourse of, you might have listened in the WhatsApp, is flooded with these messages regarding the Ayurvedic medicine of Anandayari near Nellore, who is making a kind of medicine which of course is being given though not specified for corona, but corona patient seems to be got relief from them. One thing is, it is not actually certified. So that is a science. Medicine is considered to be a science. Either it be Ayurveda or allopathy, whatever it is, it needs a certification. It needs a scientific method of trial and error to adopt them. But here we are talking about human sciences. And Levi-Strauss says that we need bricolage. The researchers in human sciences need bricolage. And though one, the person who uses this method is called bricolier. And what the bricolier is doing is to adopt the things which are surrounding him, for which he need not prepare the tools on his own, or he need not do this trial and error method, and he need not hesitate to change them whenever it appears, as Levi-Strauss did in working upon the nature-culture binary, or to try several of them at once. He can take many of the concepts at one time if their form and their origin are heterogeneous. We need not worry about the homogeneity of these several concepts that are being taken for the research in the human sciences, or say for the discourse in the human sciences. So that is why Levi-Strauss introduced this word bricolage, and Derrida feels that this is very important, or this is very significant. He says, there is therefore a critique of language in the form of bricolage. So Derrida finds in the method of bricolage that is used by Levi-Strauss a critique of language. And it has been even been said that bricolage is critical language itself. So bricolage is not only a critique of language, but it is the critical language. So here he refers to G. Jennett's Structuralism at Critic Literature, published in Homage of Levi-Strauss, you know, a article published with respect to Levi-Strauss, where it is stated that Jennett stated that the analysis of bricolage could be applied almost word for word to criticism, and especially to literary criticism. So bricolage, according to Derrida, is the way the discourse in the human sciences should follow. If one calls bricolage the necessity of borrowing one's concepts from the text of a heritage which is more or less coherent or ruined, it must be said that every discourse is a bricolier. So if you find in the human sciences, every discourse will be a, Derrida says that a bricolier. And Levi-Strauss in his research actually puts bricolier and the engineer, bricolier and the engineer in opposition. Okay. And he says the engineer whom Levi-Strauss opposes to the bricolier. So bricolier is not like an engineer. Bricolier should be the one to construct the totality of his language, syntax and lexicon. So totally he has to construct his language, syntax and lexicon. In this sense, the engineer is a myth. So according to Levi-Strauss, the engineer is a myth. A subject who supposedly would be the absolute origin of his own discourse and supposedly would construct it out of nothing, out of whole cloth would be the creator of the verb itself, that is bricolier. So the bricolier, of course, constructs his own verb, that means his own idea or his own meaning. And the notion of the engineer who supposedly breaks with all forms of bricolage is therefore a theological idea. So where the engineer is a theological idea, Levi-Strauss says that the practical is bricolage. And moreover, Levi-Strauss says that bricolage is a mythopoetic activity. A mythopoetic activity. The odds are that the engineer is a myth produced by the bricolier. As soon as we, now Derrida says that, the very idea of bricolage is, the difference, okay? Because the bricolier takes whatever is available, though they are heterogeneous in forms, okay? And Levi-Strauss describes bricolage not only as an intellectual activity, but also as a mythopoetical activity. So it is connected to a mythopoetical activity, not only with intelligence. One reads the savage mind like bricolage on the technical pane, mythical reflection can reach brilliant unforeseen results on the intellectual plane. So Derrida, of course, is very much fascinated with this idea of bricolage and bricolier, which of course finds, which of course is presenting us a critique of the language that is present in itself. And that is what Levi-Strauss applied in his research. In his research, beginning with the elementary structures and then the savage mind. And again, we come to the other book, that is The Raw and the Cooked, where actually he presents his theory. See, Levi-Strauss's remarkable endeavor does not simply consist in proposing, notably in his most recent investigations, a structural science of myths and of mythological activity. See, he did not intend to create a structural science of myths and mythological activity. Then what he did, according to Derrida, his endeavor appears, Derrida says, to have the status which he accords to his own discourse on myths, to what he calls his mythologicals. So he tried to present mythologicals, perhaps a logical explanation of myths. It is not merely a structural science of myths. So it is here, Derrida is very much impressed, and he says that it is here that his discourse on the myth reflects on itself and criticizes itself. This is the very nature of the discourse in human sciences, according to Derrida. We take the words from the same discourse and we criticize the that discourse. That is what happens with Nietzsche or Freud or Heidegger. They try to decenter, or they tried for this decentering of the center, but they used age-old words only. Because they don't have their own language, their own lexicon, their own syntax, etc. They used the old or traditional words only, and they arrived, of course, though in a different discourse, finally it ended up within the circle that is already established, that is there, the circle of the presence, which is the very nature of the Western metaphysics. That is what Derrida is trying to say. So here, of course, Levi-Strauss is differing from them. And this moment, the critical period is evidently of concern to all the languages which share the field of the human sciences. He says that what Levi-Strauss did with his ideas of bricolage, bricolier, or mythologicals, etc., is more important for all the researchers of the human sciences, because what does Levi-Strauss say of his mythologicals? It is here that we rediscover the mythopoetical virtue of bricolage. In effect, what appears most fascinating in this critical search for a new status of discourse is the stated abandonment of all reference to a center. So Levi-Strauss, thus operating on the concept of bricolage, proceeding in his study, making methods or tools from the old concepts only, though they appear to be not harmonious, though they appear to be very contradicting, he never abandoned this nature-culture binary, but he proceeded with the same thread and made that as a methodological tool for him. And making like that, he arrived at this concept of a bricolage that is presenting the abandonment of all reference to a circle or center, to a subject, to a privileged reference, to an opinion, or to an absolute archaea that is beginning. This is very important. So according to Derrida, the decentering of the center is what more important in the history of the human sciences since the time of Sophists, that means before Plato. Derrida says this does not happen in the history of the Western metaphysics, but he traces this in the works of Levi-Strauss. The theme of this decentering could be followed throughout the overture to his last book, that is The Raw and the Cooked. And here in the following paragraphs, he refers to some of the important points from this book, The Raw and the Cooked. So one important thing for today's lecture that you have to grasp is how Levi-Strauss proceeded with his research. So in the very beginning of his research, which he began with the binary of nature-culture, that means nature-culture are two opposite things. What is nature cannot be culture. What is culture cannot be nature. That is how actually he began his research in the elemental structures. That is his book. But instantly, a few steps in his research, he could recognize that this binary will not work. That is nature and culture. And while analyzing one important thing, that is the incest prohibition, which is present in some of the cultures, and which is a prohibition in some other cultures. You got my point? Incest, which I told you is having sexual relationship within the family members, is culture, and that means it is prohibited, but it is nature in some cultures, you know, some societies. You know, you are Cleopatra, Antony and Cleopatra, okay? Because Egyptian kings, pharaohs, okay, they marry their own sisters. So there, how can we say there is prohibition? And moreover, it is believed, or it is known, as I have read, it is allowed only among the members of the royal families, because they never wanted to corrupt their blood purity. They never wanted to bring impurity into their royal blood. That is why they, for them, incest is natural. Whereas perhaps for the common people, that is cultural. It is prohibited. Or if we come to other cultures, say our culture, or even English, British, they never had this. So there itself, Levi-Strauss, of course, understood that this binary is no more working, but he did not abandon that binary. Further, he worked upon that, and then he actually changed it when he arrived at the point of writing his book. Previously I mentioned, no, that book, what he says, that is Savage Mind, The Savage Mind. So there Levi-Strauss says that I began with this supposition, but this supposition no more seems to be relevant here. And now he thinks that it primarily becomes seems to be primarily a methodological importance. He makes it a tool. So that's how he never abandoned that binary that is there, but he tried to employ it as and when necessary, and leaving that when it is not necessary. And this kind of dynamic, okay, or this kind of mixture of concepts, okay? He actually called the bricolier. So the bricolier is the one who finds at his disposition the tools which are around him, which had not been especially conceived for his own subject, which are not like a trial and error method, etc. And he continued. So because he continued like that, Derrida says that Levi-Strauss arrived at a point of decentering the center. So he did not fix his research to any one particular center, subject, or reference, or archy, or origin. That is why he could, good work of, you know, mythologicals in his book, The Raw and the Cooked. And of course, how he proceeded, his reading of different mythologies, and what is the outcome of his mythologicals, and how he will not make any myth in his study of various myths. He will not make any myth a central myth, but all of them are studied relatively, like a bricolier. So how he studied and how the language of human sciences actually allows the play, okay, within the discourse of human sciences, Derrida tries to explain us with examples taken from this book, The Raw and the Cooked, and perhaps we'll continue this for the next class, and maybe we may close also this discussion with you know, Derrida's structure, sign and play. I hope you will be listening and try to get back to me. Okay, have a nice time. Bye.